Good evening, one and all. I am Advocate Anand Kumar, practicing in Delhi High Court. I am going to be your host and the moderator for today's session. My team, A.P.Legal Chambers, and I welcome you all for this 11th webinar of the series titled Is Timely Justice the Heart and Soul of the Indian Constitution? An analysis by our special speaker, Mr.P.V.SARAVANARAJA-LAW, advocate on record, Supreme Court of India. At the outset, we thank the participants for the continuous support and patronage. As always, we keep this as a request from our end to all the participants. Kindly mute your audios and, if possible, disable video from your end too. The session is a completely moderated one, and once the presentation of our special speaker gets over, APLC's APLC and the question answer session would follow. If you have any questions to ask our special speaker, kindly drop it in the chat box, and if time permits, all your questions will be answered by our special speaker. Today is the auspicious occasion of Guru Purnima. From the bottom of my heart, I thank all my gurus who have shaped me in one way or the other. I am happy to share with you all that we have crossed our first milestone of 10 webinars plus 550 followers in FB and nearing 200 subscribers on YouTube. We have over 15 and a half hours of content on YouTube. If you have missed it, any of our previous videos, please watch it on YouTube and encourage us. With each passing webinar, we are trying our level best to improve and elevate one step further. Intense research, coordination, man management, data analytics, etc. goes before organizing and hosting these webinars. We are evolving too. We have been watching the recordings of our previous webinars again and again and do error corrections. We try to give something new in each of our webinars. We come up with new segments, renowned special speakers, and interesting topics. We want to give our participants nothing but the best. We owe the entire credit of this webinar to our special speaker, Saravananraja sir. After all, we are just setting up a platform for the special speaker to connect with the participants and vice versa. For all those who are attending our webinars regularly, I am sure you all might be knowing us. For those who have come here for the first time, we are Team AP Legal Chambers, a new age law firm in Delhi NCR with a branch office in Chennai. We started our journey in the year 2017 with the vision of providing plenary services to our clients and to resolve their legal issues. APLC's portfolio covers a broad spectrum of specialized services including domestic and international taxation, constitutional laws, IPR, energy law, commercial advisory, arbitration, and corporate compliances. We started organizing these webinars out of our passion for law, and due to the extremely positive response from our participants, we are organizing these webinar series on every Thursdays and Sundays. As always, once the special speaker's presentation gets over, we shall be having the segment called APLC's APLC, Ask the Popular Learned Counsel. We have prepared a few questions from our end, and we would be asking them to our speaker. I am sure it will be both interesting and informative. In today's webinar, we shall be covering the interesting subject of timely justice, which is one of the prerequisites as enshrined in our constitution. Our special speaker here tries to analyze whether it is the heart and soul of our constitution, and at the end of the presentation, we shall have a clarity on this subject. As you all know, this is an evergreen topic. So, let me introduce our special speaker for today's webinar. Mr.P.V.SARAVANARAJA-LAW is an advocate on record, practicing in the Honorable Supreme Court of India for more than 12 years. He has dealt extensively in cases pertaining to civil laws, criminal laws, constitutional laws, etc. He recently submitted his PhD in law at GD Goenka University. As one of the young members of the bar, he had an opportunity to deliver a lecture on the topic Principles of Res Judicia at Library Number 2, Supreme Court, conducted by Friday Group, which is an academic group of the Supreme Court advocates. This was held in the month of February 2019. Our special speaker has been a resource person for conducting workshops on drafting and filing procedure of public interest litigation. He has been conducting this for the final year students of LLoyd Law College in the Greater Noida. He was awarded as the best paper presentee, and his paper adjudged as best paper of the conference at the Commonwealth Legal Education Association CLEA conference 2018. He has done his master's in contract law from the University of Madras. He was a university rank holder BABL 2002 to 2007 batch. When he was a final year law student in the year 2006-07, he served as a law clerk for a period of 1 year in the Honorable Judges of High Court of Madras. He has also represented India in the year 2007 in the William C. Wyss International Arbitration Moot Court Competition held in Vienna, Austria. When I approached him for the webinar, he wholeheartedly agreed for coming on board. Dear participants, please join me in welcoming our special speaker, Saravanan Raja sir, to the webinar. I welcome our special speaker to APLC's webinar. I am so excited to listen to his speech. Welcome on board, sir. Over to you.
Thank you so much. And happy Guru Purnima to one and all. Today is the 11th webinar series being conducted by AP Legal Chambers. We know 11 means numerical number 1. Generally, number 1 refers to leadership, positivity, and dynamism. And when double 1 joins, the positivity, leadership doubles, multiplies. Therefore, they have started with 1, now they have reached, AP Chambers reached 11, which is a great victory. I strongly believe that their successful webinar depends on their strength, depends on their hard work. Their strength depends on their constant support getting from the audience. So therefore, I wish them all success, and I'm very happy that I'm also part of this webinar. I thank the organizers as well as the wonderful audience. Now, let me come to the topic. Is timely justice a heart and soul of the Constitution? That is with the question mark. That is a question before us. So to present this paper, let me quote Socrates, the Greek philosopher, who was considered to be a father of Western philosophy. He said, "Examine yourself and examine others, question others. Unexamining life is not worth living." Therefore, taking guidance from his quote, I wanted to present this paper by raising 5 questions before this August gathering. First question is, what is the historical background of the evolution of justice? Number 2, is timely justice a heart and soul of the Indian Constitution? Number 3, are we getting timely justice? Number 4, what are the problems and solutions to get timely justice? And 5th question is, what is the conclusion? What is the result that we get out of this presentation? So with these 5 questions, let me move on to the first question, that is, what is justice and what is the historical background of justice? For this, now we are in 2020, Now we need to travel back to understand its history. I want to categorize into three types. One is ancient India, number two, medieval India, number three, modern times, that is during British era. So to travel back to ancient India, I asked our organizer Anand to help me to go back to ancient India. So he immediately accepted and provided me a time machine today. With his help, with the help of time machine, let me travel along with all this audience and go back to ancient India and to understand how the concept of justice evolved. So now, understanding this, let us go back to ancient India. In ancient India, law is otherwise called as dharma. Dharma is based on Vedas, Smritis, Puranas. Dharma is a Sanskrit term which means righteousness, which means truth, which means moral, which means pious. But nobody is there to define what is dharma is, but we can give only the meaning of it. The same question was arose in the mind of King Udhist, the eldest son of Pandavas. He asked this question, what is dharma, to his grandfather Bhishma. And Bhishma said, it is one of the most difficult questions to answer what is dharma is. But whatever you do, which is good for others, which is upliftment of living beings, is surely dharma. That is how we define what is dharma is. So whatever you do good, that is dharma. And why this concept of dharma is introduced? Because of the problems that are being faced by human beings. As a solution, dharma was introduced. So what was the problem? And where was this problem arose from? The natural problem of human beings arises from his own instinct, human instinct. So now what is the question? The question is, what is human instinct? What is this nature of human being? Number one, the desire. Whatever the action that he do, the reason behind that is desire. And desire is the cause of sorrow. That is what our Lord Buddha also said. So we can define or we can categorize these desire into two types. One is bodily desire. Number two, material desire. So to understand what is bodily desire is, we can take a classic example of Ramayana. And the classic example, the character is Ravana. Ravana, one of the most powerful king ever lived on this planet. He was a great devotee of Lord Shiva, and he is man of wisdom. He was a learned person. He knew the Vedas, inner meaning of it. And he ruled Lanka, and Lanka is a wealthy country. But he invited death because of his bodily pleasure of abducting Sita from Lord Ram. What do we get or what do we gather from this? Whatever the powerful human being you may be, but if you choose a wrong path, when you go against dharma, then you will invite your own defeat. You will invite your own death. That is what the example of Ravana is. And coming to the second desire, that is material desire. For this, the classic example is Mahabharat. Mahabharat is a fight between brothers, son of Pandavas, and this side Duryodhana and his brothers. They fought each other. Why? Because Duryodhana did not offer a share of his land to his own brothers, son of Pandavas, because he wanted to enjoy the entire land without distributing to his own brothers. Therefore, he did not follow the path of Dharma. Though he had the great warrior Karna along with him, the immortal person Bhishma along with him, Dronacharya, who taught to all the students, Guru was with Duryodhana, and all the powerful persons were with Duryodhana. But what is on this side, that is Pandavas, only Dharma, and where Dharma is, Lord Krishna was also there. So the Kurukshetra war took place. Finally, Duryodhana died. He lost his land, and Pandavas, they won. So what is the moral of the story is, from Ramayana and from the great epic Mahabharata, the moral of this story is this: where the truth is, there is Dharma. Where there is Dharma, there is God. Where there is God, there is his blessings. Where there is his blessings, there is victory. And victory is nothing but Dharma. That is what law is. So with this, we have crossed the ancient India, and let us take the time mission. Let us move on to medieval India. That is during the Muslim period was there. And I wanted to discuss under this topic by taking guidance from an article written by a retired Supreme Court judge, Justice Markandeya Kharju. In his article, he wrote, who is his ideal judge? He said his ideal judge is Judge Sirajuddin. His Lordship Markandeya Kharju had been a judge of Allahabad High Court, thereafter Chief Justice of Madras High Court, thereafter Chief Justice of Delhi High Court, then he was ultimately elevated as a Supreme Court judge. He would have seen many judges in his lifetime. He would have read so many books concerning the life of judges. But the one judge, according to him, an ideal judge, what is that special quality that he possesses which others did not? The interesting question is it not? So the same question arose in my mind also. Then the history goes like this. In 1490, a book was written on the history of Bengal by Charles author on discussing about Sultan period. The Sultan is considered to be a king, and he was considered to be a representative of God on this planet. So the facts of the case goes like this. When king himself practicing the archery, accidentally it wounded a boy who is a son of a widow. Immediately the widow knocked the doors of Judge Sirajuddin. That Sultan caused wound for his own son. So there was a thought process in the mind of Judge Sirajuddin, thinking that if we summon Sultan to appear before the court of Sirajuddin, definitely judge will be punished by Sultan. But if we do not summon Sultan to his court, if he fails from his duty, if he fails to discharge his duty, certainly one day he has to answer the court of God. Therefore, fear of God prevailed over fear of Sultan. That Sirajuddin decided to send his court officer to summon Sultan. when court officer went to Sultan's court and officer conveyed the message that he was summoned by Judge Sirajuddin, King rose instantly and he concealed sword in his garments and he came to the court of Judge Sirajuddin. Judge Sirajuddin did not bow his head, did not pay any respect to Sultan, though he is the king of that entire country, Bengal country, Bengal state. Sultan immediately, Judge Sirajuddin put a question to Sultan. Sultan, you wounded boy by your own archery, by your own arrow. Therefore, you pay a suitable compensation, or otherwise, you will be put behind bars. Immediately, Sultan turned towards the widow and said, I will pay the suitable amount. I do not want to face this sentence. So he turned towards widow and asked for suitable compensation. And she quantified. The amount was paid then and there, immediately. Then Sultan said to judge, Judge, I have paid the entire amount. Then Judge Sirajuddin asked widow, are you satisfied? Widow said yes. Based on her assent, the case was disposed of. After the disposal of the case, Judge Sirajuddin rose from his dais and came towards Sultan. Sultan told Judge Sirajuddin, I am very much proud of you, Judge, because you are not afraid of that I am Sultan, I am the king of this state. But still, you have administered justice. If you had not administered justice, if you had not summoned me, I would have chopped your head by this sword. So he took his sword out of his garments. For which Judge Sirajuddin replied, I am also very happy, King, that you obeyed my summons. Otherwise, I swear in the name of God. He took out his whip and said, if you have not answered my summons, this whip would have made your back blue and black. So from this, what we gather, King may be supreme, but law is king of kings. And fear of Sultan, fear of God is prevailed over fear of Sultan in the mind of Judge Sirajuddin. That is how he became an ideal judge, not only in the mind of His Lordship Markandeya Khadju, in my mind also, I strongly believe in your minds also. Such a judge we require, even in today's time also. Now, we have travelled from ancient India, medieval India. Now let us move on to British era, modern times. How the court evolved? In 1773, we all knew that East India Company came to India as traders. Thereafter, they started occupying the country. Because of their expansion, in their growth, the law were enforced through royal charters by the King of England. In 1773, Regulating Act was promulgated by King of England. By this promulgation, Supreme Court was established, firstly in Calcutta in 1773, thereafter in 1800 in Madras, and then in Bombay in the year 1823. Point to be noted here is, at that time there were no high courts. But in the year 1857, there was a transfer of power from the East India Company to the Crown. So Crown took the control over India, and in the year 1861, Indian High Courts Act was enacted, and they abolished the Supreme Court, which was already functioning in Calcutta, Madras and Bombay, and they established High Court at Calcutta, Madras, Bombay, Allahabad and subsequently Patna, Lahore. So by this establishing these high courts, they made the High Court as a supreme power to decide all those cases which arises within their jurisdiction. But the appeal against those high courts is usually an appeal preferred before the Privy Council, that is in Britain. So the need was felt, why should we appeal to Privy Council, which is far away situated from India? Therefore, they felt that they can appeal from the High Court to any other court like Federal Court that may function within the territory of India. That is what they felt. And ultimately, Federal Court came into functioning in the year 1935 by the Government of India Act 1935. And it kept on functioning till the enforcement of our Indian Constitution, that is on 26th January 1950. So this is how the present Supreme Court came into functioning from crossing all these historical events. Now we have covered ancient India, medieval India and modern times, and how the Supreme Court came and established and how it is functioning today. So my first question is completed with this proposition, that what was the historical background of evolution of justice. I conclude with this three types.